I've heard about this baby boy who's come to earth to bring his joy, and I just want to sing this song to you. It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift with every breath. I'm singing hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. A couple came to Bethlehem expecting child. They searched the inn to find a place for you who are coming soon. There was no room for them to stay, so when a manger filled with hay, God's only son was born. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. The shepherds left their flocks by night to see this baby wrapped in light. A host of angels led them all to you. It was just as the angel said, you'll find him in a manger bed. Emmanuel and Savior, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Well, good morning, friends, and welcome to another service of worship here at Rosenberg First Methodist Church. It's a joy to be with you today as we continue our series about the faces of hope, looking at the many ways that God has provided for us to see hope even in the midst of darkness. Today, we're focusing upon the men and women who have made us what we are, those who have gone before us to help teach us what love really is, and who have broken through the darkness and the chaos and the difficulties and whatever else we may have faced in life, those who have broken through to give us that sure foundation on which to stand. So today we give thanks for all those who've gone before us, even as we seek to find the ways that we can be that kind of loving presence for our neighbors near and far. Before we get any further in the service, I want to share just a couple of quick announcements and things going on in the life of the church. The first is that we have our final Wednesday Night Live coming up this week. That'll be the final Wednesday Night Live of the year for the children and the youth. I want to say a quick word of thank you to everybody who helped out with our Teen Life Center donations. The youth went shopping, and they were able to provide for the three families that are a part of that organization right now. If you missed it, there was a video at the end of the service last week of them decorating the Christmas tree at their last Wednesday Night Live. You can find a link to that there in the show notes today, but just really the youth have done a great job and had a great time. The kids as well, working with the to make some crafts and to drop those off for some of our homebound folks. So I'm thankful for all the work, especially that Clarissa and Risa have done to make that possible. Thank you to our kids and our youth as they have continued to stay connected and to serve our church in this time. We've got a staff gift coming up. If you want to make a donation to help with our or to celebrate the work that the staff has done this year, you can make a donation. If you click through to the online donations, there will be a staff gift option as one of the ways that you can give. If you are in church this week or next week, or if you want to make a donation in person, you can simply write staff gift there in the memo line. But that'll be a simple way to honor the work that our staff has done. That'll be divided evenly amongst the staff. I would encourage you to consider doing that. If you can't give financially, a great option would be to simply write a note to our staff, to say a word of thank you. There's been so many changes and so many difficult decisions and things that have had to happen this year. I want to encourage you to find some way to thank one of our staff members for the work that they have done to continue to help us worship, to continue helping us gather, and to stay connected throughout this year. That's either this Sunday or next Sunday. If you want to give a financial gift, we need those in by that next Monday. Or if you want to write a note or offer some other word of thank you, you can, of course, do that at any time through the end of the year. The last thing I want to mention is that our office hours are going to be a little bit different for Christmas. From the 23rd, that's Wednesday the 23rd, through Sunday, January 3rd, our office is going to officially be closed. Our staff folks should be available through email or through appointment. If there's something you really need to turn in or to let us know, we certainly will be reachable. My cell phone number should be there in the show notes if you have a pastoral emergency. We're simply going to close the office to allow the time for our staff to either visit with family or take a little time off or whatever they need to do. So if you have something urgent that needs to get done, either reach out to me if it's a pastoral emergency, or simply email one of us, and we should be able to get back to you at some point. But we're going to go ahead and close the office from the 23rd there to the 3rd. Now, friends, it's in the spirit of the hope that we have in Christ that we turn to our God now, and that we're going to do so as we light our Advent candle together.
Finding joy does not mean that everything is as perfect or pristine as a holiday card. Finding joy comes from experiencing the presence of love no matter how chaotic or messy life becomes. Mary and Joseph found this out firsthand. They came to Bethlehem, but there was no guest rooms available, so they stayed in a stable surrounded by animals. And there they found incredible joy. In that stable, Mary gave birth to Jesus. Today, we light the candle of joy to remember God is with us no matter what the seasons bring.
Dear God, thank you for your Son, Jesus. Thank you for the assurance that you will be by our side in all things. Help us live in such a way that our words and our actions help others experience the joy of your love. Amen.
Thank you. number two question is, what person or persons who are no longer with us have had a great impact on your life or faith? I actually would say Doreen Stewart. I was in my Sunday school class, and a week didn't go by that he didn't pose a question or an idea for us to all ponder.
My very good friend was Dovie Werla, and I miss her terribly. She was a wonderful, wonderful lady, and lady was the best way to describe the way she was. She was an inspiration to me all my 40-something years here.
The people that I feel like that are no longer here that had a great impact on me for this church were, I felt like Susan Jones really was one of the main people that had an effect on me. Don and Kay Metter was another, and Jack Albright also was another that I felt like had a lot of impact on me.
Fondest memories of people in the church that have passed on. One in particular stands out to me, and that's Frances Hauser. She always made me feel welcome and was always kind and loving to anyone she met.
What person or persons have influenced you in this church? This is the point where I cloud up and begin to get misty-eyed and all choked up because there have been so many people in this church. I came into this church as a married woman, great with child, her first one, and raised my family here. It was the church of my husband and his mother and aunt, and we did it all here. Esther Bowles, Florence DeLauder. There are so many, I can name these ladies and these gentlemen that made so much difference in my life and were so fantastically willing to open what was normal for them to say, look, you are the future of this church and we want to do everything to encourage you and your children to be a part of what happens here. That made a difference. Ventress Andrews was one of the first people who came to me and said, you have so much to offer the young children in this department that it thrills me to hear you play the piano and sing with them on Sunday mornings. Unfathomable in value.
The person who is no longer with us that had a major impact was Margaret Lawley. She was an inspiration to me, was her originating the Anahuac comeback after Hurricane Ike decimated High Island and the surrounding communities. We brought tools and construction materials, interacted with family members, and worked as a team to rebuild homes and help them obtain appliances.
I think the greatest is probably our previous music minister, Susan Jones. She taught me to really listen to the words of the hymns and study them, and it's made a big difference in my life.
Building here, Robert Hauser talks about when his father was involved in constructing and building this sanctuary and church area. And the fact that he actually participated a little bit playing in the sand pile that was part of the church's to be foundation, I presume.
I think about my mom. My mom quietly went about serving others without a lot of fanfare, without a lot of cymbals and loud noises. She just saw needs for people in our church, as well as in my neighborhood, the rural neighborhood where I grew up.
But Ed Bowles, he took and refinished furniture and cut the legs off to make little tea tables for my girls.
Aww.
And sang bass in the choir. I mean, he was just, you know, special, special people.
Please join me in reciting our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. A reading from Isaiah, chapter 61, verses 1 through 4 and 8 through 11. Hear now the word of the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. May the Lord bless this reading of his holy word.
Tears are falling, hearts are breaking, how we need to hear from God. You've been promised, we've been waiting. Welcome home, the child. Welcome home, the child. Hope that you don't mind a manger. Is born unto us.
Well, friends, we come to the time in our service when we're invited to share with God all that is on our hearts and minds in prayer. Today, there's one specific request that was lifted up that I want to share with you. Margaret Richardson's Aunt Dorothy was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer this week. So we certainly want to lift up her aunt and all of her friends and family. She was only given 1 to 3 months to live, so I know this is a very difficult time for them all. So please keep Margaret's aunt in your prayers this week. And continue to pray for all of those who are struggling or going through difficult times. Pray for those who may be traveling or trying to visit family, for those who can't visit family right now, and for just all those situations that we're going through in the midst of this holiday season. We want to lift each and every one of them up in prayer, trusting that God will receive all of our prayers and through everything will make us new. So it's in that spirit now that we turn to our God in prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, we give you thanks for this moment when we can set aside the worries of our everyday life, for this moment when we can focus our eyes solely upon you. We ask that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit in this holy time. Fill us with your Spirit so that we might see your face more clearly. Fill us with your Spirit so that we might hear your voice calling out to us by name. Fill us with your Spirit so that we might go from this place wherever we are right now, so that we might go in the strength of your love and your grace to share your love to the very ends of this earth. We pray in all our times of trial and struggle, in times of illness and chaos and difficulty, in each of these moments, God, remind us that you are the Good Shepherd. Remind us that you sent your Son into the world to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim release to the captives, to set each of us free so that we would know nothing but your love, your grace, and your forgiveness. In those times of joy and celebration, God, remind us of all those good and perfect gifts you poured out into our lives. Help us to give from the abundance that we have first received so that your grace and your love would not end with us, but would overflow to the lives of our neighbors near and far. God, today we pray and we give thanks especially for those men and women who have made such an impact on our life and our faith. For those men and women, for all of those people who have helped us to know that you are here by our side. For those people who have broken through all the noise and all the chaos to be a sure foundation of your love and acceptance. We give thanks for them and ask that you help us to go out and make that same kind of difference in the lives of your children. So God, today we lift up all the joys and concerns of our hearts, all those spoken and unspoken and those that only you know. We ask that you wrap them all in your arms of grace. And God, through everything, draw us closer to you. It's in your Son's name that we pray as we join in the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our second reading for the day comes from the Gospel according to John chapter 1. Hear now the word of the Lord. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees, and they asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you neither are the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not unworthy to tie the thong of his sandals." This took place in Bethany across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. Friends, this is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Almighty God, hide me behind your cross, so that it might be your word that is spoken this day, so that it might be your Holy Spirit that touches our lives and makes us new. Amen. Before we are anything else, we are loved, we are accepted, we are enough. Each and every one of us, each and every part of us. I've said this before, and I will keep saying it. If you remember nothing else that I ever say or do, I hope that you remember this. My dad actually started poking fun at me because of how often this very sentiment comes up in my preaching. And I kind of appreciate him doing so because it means that he's noticed how often I say it. It means that maybe I'm starting to say it often enough. Before we are anything else, we are loved, we are accepted, we are enough. Each and every one of us, each and every part of us. This simple statement is the most succinct way I've found to share what I believe is the most important building block of the Christian faith, the most important building block that we have to offer. Today, I'll tell you why. And we're going to start with our reading from John's Gospel, which picks up where we left off last week. Last week, John came onto the scene baptizing people in the wilderness. We were invited in Mark's Gospel and all that we do to prepare the way of the Lord. John's Gospel peels back the curtain just a little bit to show what we are preparing for. The action in this reading is actually quite similar to what we saw in Mark's Gospel. John is there baptizing people in the River Jordan, and a quote is offered from the prophet Isaiah to reveal to the crowd who he is, to reveal to them that he's there to prepare the way for Jesus Christ. The main difference in the details that John includes is a clarity about why John actually tells the crowd who he is. John reports that the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He told them that he was not the Messiah, which is to say, he was not the one that they had been waiting for. He was not the one who had been promised long before that time. He was not the one who would set all things right and make all things new. Instead, he told them, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord. I baptize with water. The one who is coming after me already stands among you, yet you do not know him. I am unworthy to tie the thong of his sandals.'" Verses 7 and 8 summarize this whole scene for us in this way. They say, "John came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but John came to testify to the light." In this passage, John offered a witness to the meaning and the significance of Jesus, the Messiah. John did what he did to help make the same kind, or to make sure that the life and the teachings of Jesus would break through it all. He did so to make sure that Jesus' life and message would break through the noise and confusion and chaos of his day. John offered this testimony in order to reveal the truth that we still need to remember, even now. Testimony can be a sort of a churchy word, you see. It's one of those words that we probably all know well enough to assume that we get it, but we don't all know it so well that we actually mean the same thing when we use the same word. If you're like me and you watch pretty much every courtroom or police drama on TV, you at least probably have one aspect of the meaning down of that word, testimony. Anytime a crime happens, the police or the lawyers find the people who have some sort of knowledge of what has been done and by whom it might have been done. These are the witnesses. And witnesses may be asked to give testimony in a court or at the police station. They say what they saw or knew about the relevant crime in that moment. And the more believable, the more knowledgeable that witness, the more likely the jury or the judge or police or whoever are going to be to accept their testimony as truth. And this simple idea, this simple framework, is what you might call see something, say something, do something. The witness sees something, their testimony says something about what they saw, and then everyone goes about doing something based on their role and how much they trust that witness. The police might make an arrest, the jury might convict, the judge might rule on a motion, etc., etc. And in the church, we use this same sort of formula sometimes. Seems operative underneath a lot of the ways we talk about testimony. back in 2008, witness was added to the membership vows of the United Methodist Church. To witness is to give testimony. And every church member, every person who joins the church now commits in that ceremony to supporting the church by their prayers, their presence, their gifts, their service, and their witness. In the church, that's a witness about what someone has experienced. That witness is someone who experiences the love and the presence of God in their lives. And that witness who offers testimony stands before the church to share about their experience. And they do so in part because such profound experiences simply beg to be shared. And they share in part because they speak in the hope that their experience might open the door to another child of God, to another child of God coming to know the love of God on a deeper level. They have seen something that God has done. They have said what their experience was all about. And the whole church hopes that someone will be led to do something next. That someone will come to know Christ for themselves, or that they'll be moved to action, or maybe even to share their own story. See something, say something. Everybody goes and does something. You can see how that framework works out. That same sort of formula plays out with John the Baptist. The leaders have come to question why John is doing crazy things out in the wilderness. John has seen what God was about to do through Jesus Christ. John says what he has come to proclaim, that I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, make straight the ways of the Lord. And then the people all do something based on how much they believe the testimony of that witness. John baptizes in the River Jordan. Many people leave there that day and they become believers and they become followers of John as his disciples and eventually of Jesus. And the leaders who came to question John, they actually go back and they continue to resist the possibility of change. Everybody in the story has their own respective roles, so they see that formula, see something, say something, then they all go and do something. There's nothing exactly wrong with this framework of understanding witness and testimony, but there is one change that is absolutely crucial if we want that testimony to make a lasting impact. There's one slight change we have to make in our expectations of the outcome or the point offering that testimony. You see, it's fine in court for everyone to go their separate ways and to simply do what needs to be done in their respective roles. But in a life of faith, the goal is the opposite. The goal is not to offer a tidbit of information that you can accept or reject so that everyone can go on their own way and live their own lives. The goal in a life of faith is to break through all the noise, to break through all the chaos, to break through all the distractions of life in order to make life and love and relationship possible. The step that actually changes lives is not a single moment of witness. That moment of witness is the moment that opens the doors to what truly matters. It's much more like see something, say something, love someone. John understood this very well. He knew that his witness was not the point of the story. He knew that he didn't come into this world to share a message, but he shared a message to make way the love and relationship of Jesus Christ. His testimony was not meant to change lives. He came to prepare the way for the one who would change everything. No amount of words or knowledge could ever provide a sure foundation of love and acceptance, that sure foundation that was so desperately needed in life. I mean, often it takes words, it takes a story, it takes a moment in order to break through. But on the other side are not more words or facts or beliefs or ideas. On the other side is the reality that we are already who God has said we are. We are God's children, wonderfully made, relentlessly pursued. Before we are anything else, we are loved, we are accepted, we are enough. Each and every one of us. Each and every part of us. I can remember the moment that broke through for me. It was a midwinter camp around the sophomore year of my high school career. The last night of that camp, we had a great night of worship and music, and at the end, the band kept playing. We were invited to simply sit and to pray for as long as we wanted in that room. At some point, my youth director came over and he prayed with me, and I remember nothing that he said at all that night. But I do remember feeling that love and that embrace washing over me. That love and that embrace of my Lord and Savior, feeling that for the first time in that way. It was like nothing that I'd ever noticed before. And in that moment, my faith became real. I had always been a church person, but I never really got it. And only much later could I finally put into words what it was that I got on that in that moment, on that night. You see, that moment wasn't actually the point. That moment was when my eyes were opened to see what had been true all along. That moment helped me to experience the embrace of a love that had been by my side ever since the day and the moment of my birth. That feeling of constancy, that feeling of presence, that was something that I knew in my bones. But I didn't know it because of some statement of belief or some story that I'd read or some single moment in time. I knew it because my parents had always been that kind of constant, loving presence in my life. I never had the doubt that they loved me. And I knew it because of the people who had dedicated their lives to helping me grow in Christian community for my entire life long. Earlier today, we heard several stories of those men and women from this very church who helped make us what we are. And those stories are a testimony to the impact this church has had throughout the years. It's a testimony to the men and women who've helped teach us what love really is. And at the same time, those stories can only ever point the way. Those stories are as much a celebration of those who has come before us as they are marching orders for us to love the people around us here and now. To be that kind of constant, loving presence is the single most important means we have to effectively give witness to our faith, to effectively transform the world. Witness is not about the words we say, although needing words is simply a part of being human. Witness, at its core, is about being the hands and the feet of God here and now, so that every child of God will know that we are who God has already said we are. And I find it far too easy to complicate what's really quite simple. As a philosophy major and a person who loves to read and write, I'm often guilty of doing so. But it doesn't take a fancy argument or complex programs to transform the world. What it takes is both far more simple and far more challenging. It takes a willingness to show up, a willingness to put in the time, to pay attention and to listen and to learn to love one another, to love another broken, imperfect child of God. It takes our willingness to see something, to say something, to love someone. To be that kind of presence is what it takes to break through all the noise and to change everything. A while back, a woman named Nadine Burke Harris did research that showed just how profoundly transformative it can be to have a stable, loving presence in our lives. See, she's a doctor and a researcher who noticed how many common health problems there were that were experienced by her patients. Her patients came to her in a community clinic, which meant that they were largely a poorer and a more minority-focused population. They didn't have the time or the money to invest in high-end specialty care, which is part of what helped inspire her to try and get at the root causes of such poor community health. She didn't assume, like we often do, that the problem is the result of poor choices or nutrition or some other individualistic kind of cause. She wanted to get at the real root of this community health crisis that she saw unfolding around her. And what she found in her research may very well be the most significant public health crisis that most of us have never heard of. She discovered a surprising common cause for health problems as diverse as heart disease or diabetes. What she found was that so many of her unhealthy clients had experienced a number of adverse childhood experiences, also called ACEs for short. ACEs are things like being abused by a parent or having an alcoholic parent in the household, or maybe a parent being arrested and going to prison. There were 10 primary ACEs that she identified at the start of her work, and she began looking for a connection between how many of these adverse childhood experiences her patients had and their long-term health outcomes, their physical health that she was trying to help them overcome. The more ACEs someone had, she found, the more likely they were to have long-term health complications. And the correlation she found was huge. As just one example, she found that the number of ACEs someone had was a better predictor of heart disease and diet, or it was a better predictor of heart disease than diet or genetics ever was. So the number of ACEs you had, if you had more ACEs, you could predict heart disease and you could predict heart disease better than you could if you knew a person's diet or genetic family history. The number of ACEs was extremely correlated with a lot of long-term difficult health outcomes. And one of the clear biological reasons for that connection is something called toxic stress. Anytime we're stressed out or something causes stress in our bodies begin to produce hormones like cortisol. And those hormones are great for putting us on high alert in a crisis. They help our focus sharpen, our senses become heightened. But when those same hormones constantly flood our bodies, they can do significant, lasting damage. ACEs are a primary source of that kind of toxic stress. Something like having an alcoholic parent in the house puts kids at a constant need to be on high alert. They're always paying close attention to know when mom or dad is safe and when they might be drunk. And one of the most effective ways to treat ACEs just might be more surprising than realizing how harmful ACEs are in the first place. You see, not everyone with ACEs has long-term health consequences. The biggest difference is not a pill or an exercise regimen or a special diet that you could put someone on. The biggest difference is one caring adult, one person who's present in that child's life, one person who can be counted on, who knows the child and is willing to show up for them. That person might be a parent or an aunt or a teacher or a mentor or just about any other role in the child's life. But the best way to counteract the toxic stress of ACEs is to have one adult in a child's life, one adult who shows them unconditional positive regard. Unconditional positive regard is kind of a therapist-y way of naming the kind of love and acceptance that God has for each and every one of us, that kind of love and presence that we are called to have for one another. If we want to make a difference, if we want to transform the life and the future of our neighbors in every way, from both spiritual life to physical health, if we want to transform our world and bring health and healing, the most effective way to do so is as simple as it is challenging. We are invited to love one another in the way that God has first loved us. The main reason that Jesus came into our world that first Christmas day was to make this love a reality. In the words of Isaiah, Christ was sent to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners. In short, Christ came to be by our side no matter what. Christ came to love us until healing takes place. Christ came to break through all the noise and all the distractions until the love and relationship of God is the very foundation upon which we stand. And it might take an eloquent speech or an earth-shattering moment for us to realize what has always been true. It might take that to remind us that before we are anything else, we are loved, we are accepted, we are enough. Each and every one of us, each and every part of us. There's no telling what it might take to help us realize what is already true. But this is the truth upon which all else stands. And when the truth breaks through, we're invited to be a community of love and acceptance for God's children near and far. We're invited to become a community that continues to make love real, to make healing and wholeness possible. In short, we're invited to be witnesses who testify about the love of God. We're invited to see something, to say something, to love someone. Doing so is both more simple and far more challenging than we might like to admit. Doing so is also the only way to break through the noise, to break through the chaos, to break through the distractions of our world, so that every child of God would come to know the power and the presence of the one who came to be by our side, so that all would know the one who came to offer life and joy and hope, so that all would know the one who came so that even death itself would die. Friends, we have seen the face of hope, and his name is Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Blossoms fly. Joyful all ye nations arise, join the triumph of the skies, with the angelic host proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord, late in time behold him come, offspring of a virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity, pleased with us in flesh to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, is with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that we no more may die, born to raise us from the earth, born to give a second birth. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Well, friends, this concludes our service of worship for the day. Thank you once again for joining with us. Don't forget, if you want to make a contribution toward the staff gift, you can do that until for the next 8 days until next Monday. You can also write a note or drop that off for one of our staff members anytime through the end of the year. Christmas Eve, don't forget, we have 1 7 o'clock service of worship in person. We'll, of course, do an online service that will show up at that time as well. If you're going to come to the in-person service, I would encourage you to RSVP. That'll simply help us with planning. You don't have to do so, but letting us know how many folks are going to show up would be very helpful for our planning. It will be a service of candlelight and communion. Now, friends, receive these words as your benediction. Friends, go forth in the grace and the love of our God, knowing that God is with us throughout all that is to come, remembering that God is the one who has broken through the darkness to show us the light. And so, friends, may we follow after our Lord and our Savior through all that is to come, and may we share his love with everyone we meet. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.